Greetings, Tenno. My name is Blythe here. So I said I'd jump back into Warframe lore, and here we are talking about the Chimera update, and how it links into the lore and the ongoing story between the Sacrifice and the upcoming New War expansion. It should be arriving next year. I'm very excited to see what happens on that front, especially considering the revelations of the Sacrifice, on the front of both Ballas' involvement and, of course, with the story of the Lotus evolving even further. But yeah, with all that said, spoilers abound. Seriously, big spoilers. If you haven't played the update, it should be available for all of you after you've completed the Sacrifice, so yeah, go play it. And another couple of things as well. I know I'm really late to this, but a few months ago was a very weird time, and before that there was certain other games that may or may not have been taking my attention, so yeah, we're just getting back to this a little bit late. And before I start, yeah, I do need to talk about something else, which is something which you guys actually requested to start off with, and it's regarding the format of these lore videos specifically for Warframe. I worked it previously into a sort of narrative framework, but quite a few of the videos, there was a little bit too much show and not enough tell. And given that recently, I've been taking a lot more feedback and listening a lot more to what you guys have been saying, and trying to figure out where my content stands, I kind of agree with a lot of what you guys said. It works really nicely in some cinematic facets, but for the rest it doesn't really fit as well, and there could be a lot more contextual explanation behind everything. So, this is still going to have some gameplay and dialogue, but there's a lot more explanation that I want to give you guys where possible. So let me know what you prefer in the comments below, but for the moment we're going to try a format which is a little bit more similar to my other Destiny content. We'll see if that improves and is worthwhile for you guys. Anyway, this video is also special because it's actually been sponsored by our wonderful friends over at Discord, who've recently launched their own store. Just like you might expect, Warframe is free on the Discord store, but there's also this neat little thing that they have called Discord Nitro. To give you the really basic summary of it, for $9.99 a month, you get access to the Nitro Games Library, and you can play 75 featured games there, all of which are worth about $1,000 worth of games that you can just play whenever. So that's nice in itself, but the really sweet deal is for when Warframe is involved. You see, Nitro has a special Warframe bundle going on right now, and if you do grab Nitro, you can access this bundle, which comes with 440 plat, 7-day credit, resource and affinity boosters, and 3 special skins for Excalibur, Mag, and Vault. So if you're looking to flesh out your fashion frame a little bit, or if you're just looking to grab a little bit of extra platinum, go ahead and consider getting Nitro. It's a 1-month subscription, so you can of course cancel it after that, and maybe you find a game that you like in the featured library. Who knows, maybe you enjoy it more. Either way, that's our sponsor for this video. Thank you so much to the guys at Discord. And without much further ado, my apologies for the long intro, let's get to this lore. So for those of you that didn't play The Sacrifice, you best know that this revolves around the character Ballas, who is the center of The Sacrifice, and to say that Ballas is a big deal in the lore would be a rather sizable understatement. He is one of the foundational characters that's responsible for the way the world current is in Warframe, and the Chimera update is really an extension of his story and his love for Margulis. Again, I say this one more time, if you haven't played Sacrifice, go do that now because you need this context, you really do. I'm going to base a lot of this with some idea that you may be new to it, but even so, I'm just going to go forward and assume that you will have played Sacrifice. Whilst there's room for a really extensive video on Ballas as well, I do think the important part to understand for this story is actually his love of Margulis and how that relates to content all the way back to the Second Dream. So yeah, maybe I'll end up making a video on that more. The tentative plan I want to try and put forward is to cover Warframe every fortnight because, frankly, there isn't enough content on this channel on this game, and I really want to expand on that. But again, that's ambitious thinking, we'll see about it, and there's lots of stuff going on with me personally around moving into apartments and stuff, so yeah, we will see what happens on that front. Anyway, to give you the briefest version of Ballas' character for what is necessary to understand this video, is that Ballas was an executor of the ancient Orokin Empire, and I know someone is going to say it's Orokin versus Orokin, but pronunciation is weird for that word. Can we land on an official pronunciation over at Digital Extremes, maybe? I don't know. Anyway, his lover was the Archimedean Margulis, the metaphorical mother of the Tenno. She was unique in the story of the Orokin because she didn't shun the Tenno, who at this stage were void-empowered remnants of the Zaramen 10-0 disaster. For more on that, you should probably check out my first Warframe lore video. Margulis would go on to love most of the Tenno and would help them control their powers, although the process would, at a certain point, leave her blinded. Ballas counseled Margulis against allowing the Tenno to go on living, believing, as many Orokin did, that they were imperfect in comparison to the immortal Orokin, calling them void-possessed devils and words to that effect. And this belief is not necessarily immediately unreasonable in every regard. Now, don't get me wrong, it's a certain level of xenophobic and very much is fear of an other that they don't understand, but at the same time, the Tenno and their powers are dangerous and unstable, and after somebody has wounded the person you love, you probably hold a bit of a grudge quite reasonably. Margulis, however, disagreed fervently with this idea, stating that the Tenno could in fact be a force for good, and would not quite so easily give up on the children that she so loved. And as a result, she went before the Seven, and this led to her execution by the Jade Light. However, Margulis had been working on ways for the Tenno to more ably control their powers, and this included the initial work on what would come to be known as transference, aka the process by which a Tenno operator can take control and imbue vessels with their power and actions, thus allowing them to fight by proxies. Balus would continue this work in spite of his hatred for the Tenno, and this was partly due to the arrival of a new and more pressing threat. It was at this point that the old war with the Sentients would begin, and Balus and his executors found that the traditional fighting forces of the Orokin and the weapons that they wielded would be ineffective. The Sentients were constantly capable of adapting and changing their weapons and tactics, and even their defenses, so that they could best counter the Orokin. And though they were advanced, the Orokin found themselves completely ineffective against the Sentients over time, and it was at this point that they decided to use a special strain of what would be known as the Infestation. Balus would use this to create biomechanical proxies for the Tenno that they could use to fight the Sentients. These biomechanical proxies, birthed from sword steel and human candidates likely unwilling to undergo the transformation, would be known as Warframes, and are still piloted by the Tenno through transference today. The interesting thing, of course, about why these were so successful is partly based in the fact that Warframes in themselves are adaptable and were able to use the old weaponry of gun and blade, but more so than just that, the Tenno had the powers of the Void on their hand, and the Void is poison to the Sentients. Now, the sacrifice back in the day did reveal quite a lot of interesting details on Balus and where his true allegiances lie. The Vitruvian and the visions of Umbra in particular tell us quite a bit about the fact that he did indeed have changing allegiances, and in the end actually does side with the Sentients. But once again, this is all based on his love of Margulis, and this is where things get interesting, because all of a sudden we get to the Sentient side of the story with the Lotus. For those that don't know, Space Mom is a Sentient. If you've made it to Natar, you'll know that for certain, but who knows, we might have some newly awakened operators in the crowd. Either way, the prevailing point is that the Lotus, as she would come to be known, switched sides. Back when she was known as Natar, she was Hun Hao's daughter and was serving with the Sentients under Hun Hao's command. Lotus was a crucial part of a plan to eradicate the Tenno, but instead of doing this, feeling despair at her inability to reproduce after having been exposed to the Void like all other Sentients, Natar opted to hide the Tenno away in the second dream, and took up a new personality in the form of the Lotus. She would take Margulis' place as the would-be mother of the Tenno. And as a result, she shares a lot of parallels and similarities to Margulis, and even mimics her in appearance. This is going to become crucial for the next part of what happens in the cycle as we go back to Balus, and it's at this point where we reach the Apostasy Prologue, and we witness here a scene by which Balus and the Lotus meet in person, and where Balus promises to never abandon her like he did to Margulis. It seems somewhat clear that he sees the personality of Margulis in the Lotus, who was sort of mirroring Margulis anyway, and that point becomes rather interesting for later points as to whether we can trust the Lotus. The pair then join hands, and then the Lotus removes her helmet and they walk away, and quite understandably they leave you alone, very confused and holding Space Mom's helmet. And no one is quite sure what the hell happened at first, but this of course then led to the sacrifice, where we would eventually see Balus critically wounded, we would discover our new Umbra Excalibur frame, and at the very end, we would see an unidentified sentient frame descend from orbit, which, oh my god, it's Space Mom, it's the Lotus, there we go. Suddenly the deception makes a little bit more sense. Time being, it was a pretty shocking end, and it left a lot of unanswered questions and clearly pointed to where the future of the story was going, and that will lead us neatly into Chimera, But one last thing we need to understand before we go into any of this, so that the full context is there, is the Man in the Wall, because this quest involves the Man in the Wall somewhat too. For those of you who don't know what the Man in the Wall is, play Chains of Harrow, but for those of you who are still blank on that one, the Man in the Wall is often believed by best speculation to be a presence, an amoral or malevolent one that is, that lives within the Void. It's possible that they are the personification of the Void itself, but all things thus far are very much speculative. If you're looking for more context on that again, there's a video I did on the Chains of Harrow quest, and you will be able to find a little bit more to understand there. You should also probably take a look at the War Within. At the end, there's kind of a hint to it. The Chimera prologue in this one, though, is an interesting one because there's another interesting question of his motivation that we need to start asking, and in particular, we will ask ourselves whether or not the Man in the Wall can be trusted with this too. So with all that said, and with all these different moving pieces in place now, let's talk Chimera, which starts with us in our orbiter. The Man in the Wall is clearly tempting us in here, but the underlying reason for this, as will be evident throughout this whole prologue, is unknown. We're transported in what appears to be a vision to Lua. More specifically, the part of Lua that we visited during the Second Dream and the Apostasy prologue. We end up following the Man in the Wall and fighting shades that take the form of the Lotus. These shades appear to be the same conjurations of the Void that we faced when fighting off Rel in the Chains of Harrow, although they take on a distinctly more female figure and have the Lotus's headdress. So, it's not totally clear what's trying to be implied here, but it's possible the Man in the Wall is trying to point us towards what our foe should be. Maybe it's one of these questions that's trying to point us in the direction of, can we trust the Lotus? Is she not really our enemy? All of this, of course, is purely speculative, and there's a lot that we could be looking into with regards to the motivation again of the Man in the Wall. We at last reach the chamber from the Apostasy prologue, and here we have the ability to step through a portal in the place where we found the Lotus. This portal then teleports us into this chamber, which appears to be the interior of a giant sentient installation. The best speculation from other parts of the Warframe community points to the possibility of this being the sentient mother, who the Lotus fled with Balus's body to. Teleporting further and further into the chamber, we can see what can only be described as a grotesque sight. Balus has been irrevocably changed. There's a real bit of irony here, considering that the Orokin consider themselves beautiful and perfect, and now Balus, after having pursued what he believed to be his love and one of his ultimate purposes in life, he has become what is frankly an abhorrent monstrosity, a blend of sentient and Orokin. This, of course, leading to the idea of the Chimera. Balus mumbles a variety of things to himself, including how his perfect death has been stolen by Natar. It appears as well that he's become a part of the greater network of sentient under her control. This especially we can tell from his vision, which is possessed by the Lotus, albeit only in his right eye. We're shielded from sight in this encounter for the most part. We're exploiting the fold, the space between the Void and real space that we can use to pass unseen. But we have to avoid Balus's gaze, as Natar's vision is capable of breaking through and seeing all things. And if we are discovered, terrible things await us. As we dart from each part of the chamber to another, Balus's babbling madness continues. And he talks about the adept deception we have all endured at Natar's hands.
But she gave me the gift of life. Why would I betray her? This is no gift. She stole my death. my perfect death. Such is her power over me, over the devil. We saw what we wanted, those devils and I. A lover. A mother. But now, what is this? I'm just confused. A lover. A mother. Oh, is this someone? Only shadow. Only shadow. A lover. A mother. But now, I know.
Valis acknowledges here that the sentient Natar was able to appear as what was desired by both the Tenno and himself, be it a mother figure to replace those parents lost by the Tenno to the Zaraman 10-0 disaster, or a lover to replace the dead Margulis that he himself was unable to save.
She is neither. She's a hawk calling with sparrow's song. A viper blending into wood. Huh? Okay. And her venom spreads not into flesh, but into your heart.
It is then that we can hear him talk further about the impact that we as Tenno have caused on the system.
Those devils! What has their great awakening accomplished but the destruction of potential allies? Don't they see?
It's implied here that by consistently attacking the Corpus and the Grineer and all the other parties within our system, that we've been actively weakening those that might help us oppose the sentience, giving us a real reason to doubt the morality of the Lotus in the first instance. With all this said, Balas reaches his conclusion that the Lotus was a lie and that there was only ever one personality, a deceptive one. The sentient Natar was the only thing that ever existed all along.
Love must die, as Margulis did when I sent her to the Jade Light. And the Lotus, just some cloud in the sky, just some shape they imagined. Only the sentient is real.
Whether this is truth or merely Balas's perspective that has been understandably biased by his affliction is one thing that we may take time to discover. Finally, Balas acknowledges our presence and offers us a boon that we might claim some form of vengeance. As we have been darting around the chamber, a sword has slowly been forming at the center. Something being forged from Balas's hands, a design of his mind. And now, he gifts this to us.
So, tell me, devil, do you understand what must be done? The Parasthesis, the Sentient Slayer. Hurry, take this, the idea of it. It is the only way your war can end.
With the schematic for the Parasthesis now recovered, we have a boon against the sentience. Something that we might use to fight back. And with the new weapons schematic committed to memory, we are now a little readier for the coming conflict. When the new war begins, we shall have the ability to fight back, thanks to Balas and his actions here. But questions still abound. Can we even make a difference against the vast sentient force with this blade in hand alone? Is the Lotus's deception a part of a plot to double-double-cross the sentience? Or has she truly been captured once more by her mother? Or maybe is the idea of the Lotus, as Ballas suggested, merely a great deception by the sentient Natar? And why has the man in the wall led us to this place? Why did he show us this vision? Why did he send forms of strange apparitions that mimicked the Lotus to attack us? And why in the first place would he let us through this portal that allowed us to see the vision of Ballas? There are so many things that are left unclear. This has undoubtedly progressed the plot significantly. But one thing cannot be put into question. One thing we know for certain. A war is coming. A war with greater stakes than any that have come before. A war that will leave us either destroyed in the wake of the forces of the sentient, or changed irrevocably. A new war is coming. And this time, our victory is not certain. Thank you very much for watching, and if you enjoyed that video, please do feel free to go ahead and leave a like. I know this is the last video I'll probably get out before Christmas, so thank you so much for continuing to watch the content. We will resume with this after the Christmas break has gone on. I am still doing quite a lot of moving stuff, so the video content has been a little bit slower than it would be normally. When it comes to the new year, I'll be a little bit more moved in, but even then, there's a lot that I still need to do. So, just so you're all well aware, things are progressing, but it's still not quite completely there, and it may be a little bit more time until I'm up to full production standards once more. If you had any commentary about the video, please do go ahead and leave that down below. Tell me if you enjoyed this format where I was explaining a little bit more in depth, more than you enjoyed the narrative or cinematic one that we've done with the previous videos. It'll inform what I do with content going forward aside from anything else. And of course, if you want more Warframe and Destiny and Anthem lore content, you should hit the subscribe button. And if you want notifications on that, you can hit the bell next to subscribe to turn on email notifications. But, of course, know that your viewership is quite enough for me. And in the meantime, my name has been My Name is Bife. Perodacia Arastra. I'll see you, Starside.